Today we are in Western Panama looking for millipedes. There are large flat form millipedes out here and there are giant round form millipedes. So hopefully we're able to find a good number of species and conditions are pretty good for them. We'll do a little bit during the day and I think we'll look at night as well. Oh, nice. There's one of the millipedes I'm looking for. This one right here. Let me pull it up. This is a millipede that's either Pachydesmus or something very closely related. And millipedes with this form that are quite large and have these flanges are called tractor millipedes. No, let's wait for it to uncurl. So the millipede has started to kind of uncurl here, so we can see it a bit more clearly what its shape is like. This is a classic polydesmid. Like many, it excretes cyanide, something I can smell right now. Has kind of a smells like almonds. This would be something that's dangerous to ingest, but the absorption through the skin supposedly is not harmful in almost any way. And you can see this one's kind of slow moving, but once they start to pick up speed, they can actually go quite fast. Let's put it back in its log. There's a helmeted iguana in there, trying to get out of the rain. I'm gonna see if I can catch it. Got him. Nice. And by the way, despite being called helmeted iguanas, they're not actual iguanas. And iguanas are mostly vegetarian, but since these guys aren't actually iguanas, their diet is a lot like other lizards. They eat mostly insects and spiders and stuff like that. Any terrestrial arthropods. But they have been known to feed on little lizards sometimes, which I think is kind of cool. And this bone here that's responsible for making this hood is actually fused to the skull. All right, I'm gonna show you this millipede species once, and then I'm not gonna record anymore because they're not the most exciting. This one is all curled up, so I'm gonna unravel it really quickly. All right, here it is, walking around now. I had to manually uncurl it, but that's fine. Doesn't really hurt the millipede. And I think these are full grown because I've seen quite a few of them and none of them have been any larger. But if I see any millipedes that are larger than this or a different species that are the same size, I'll definitely show them to the camera. Ooh, there's a big millipede back here. I could just barely see it. That I would have definitely missed had I not looked. This thing is a monster. And as I often do with these millipedes, I'm going to wait for this one to unravel so we can see just how large it is. This may be the heaviest millipede I've ever held to date. Surprisingly, I've seen longer ones back in California, but this one is seriously thick. It reminds me of Narcissus gordanus, the smoky oak millipede. I'm not an expert on millipedes, but these may be in the genus Narcissus. We have a harvestman here, an Epilion. There's quite a few of them out here. They love this habitat, especially where the forest canopy is a bit more dense. This one seems to have grown a little larger than the rest of the ones I'd seen out here. So took my time to get this one on camera. It's quite cool. Here's one of those dragon millipedes, just not an adult. Hasn't put its colors on. It's very small. I just flipped this big log and in classic fashion, we have leafcutter ants with their brain in a big cavity. And then over here, possibly the coolest thing we'll see in this whole video, an albino millipede. The post-ectasis colors of a millipede only last maybe a day at most, 2 days. Meanwhile, one that is hypomelanistic will be like this its whole life. And for that reason, I will keep it for 2 days in a container with some wood, and then we'll look at it after so that anyone who thinks that this is just post-molts can see it a bit differently. Oh, that's cool. There's a regular one here. We'll put that next to the albino one. Oh, damn. Look at this guy. That's really cool. Another albino millipede. It's got to be a population thing then. Here I am about 2 days later with these polydesmids. Here's the normal one. And back here, we have the other ones, the hypomelanistic ones. Quite predictably, they haven't changed color. Because they never will. There's a pseudoscorpion down there as I'm filming these millipedes. There's a couple things that I should mention about these albino millipedes. Albino millipede populations are more rare than the albino millipedes themselves. The thing is, Finding a population as it is very tough, but if you know where an albino millipede population is and you can easily find the millipede just albino or not, and you know where to look for them, coming across one within that population may not be super tough. But in addition to that, finding albino millipedes is easier than finding albino grasshoppers, for example. And there's a reason for that. Albinism is known from several millipede species. You may have even heard of the albino Narcissus americanus. And the reason that you can actually find albino millipedes is not because they're more common to begin with, it's just because of their lifestyle. Other albino animals will come to the surface, they can get easily spotted, and then they get picked off. Meanwhile, these millipedes are always living inside wood, under logs, underground. But the explanation doesn't really stop there. These millipedes still come out at night, just like many other millipede species do. And you may think, well, maybe that's when the predators can come and pick them off. Not really. These millipedes rarely come out of their logs and underground, but one of their only predators doesn't hunt them based off of visual cues, so albinism doesn't really make a difference for them, and that would be the millipede eating beetle, which is a larva that looks a lot like a glowworm. We've got a fairly large weevil down here, and I think this may be one of the ones that lays its eggs in palms. It's not the classic one that has the orange streaking down the back, known classically as the palm weevil. But I wouldn't be surprised if this one infects those plants as well. Either way, I am very impressed by this specimen. And look, these legs in the front are very long, like abnormally long, and they have these spines. They have hooks, four of them. Look at all that pitting on the thorax and the elytra. Very cool beetle. For anyone who doesn't already know, if you find leaves that have rows of circles in them that are fairly neat, that's probably a weevil that's been feeding on them. All right, these are considered pests, but that's fine. They're native, so I'm gonna let this one go back to doing beetle things. We've got a pretty interesting log underside here. So down here, we have a regular tractor millipede, and then we have one of these guys over here, spirobolid. But over here, we have another albino. Seems that they aren't super tough to find, almost kind of a guarantee in this area. And that little amount of liquid there is cyanide. Next to this tractor millipede, we have a pill millipede looking thing. Not sure what it is, but I've heard of it before. It's really cool. Forgot the name. There was a second one hanging out in the dirt here. Millipedes that are able to roll up into a ball like this, or any animal really, is called conglobation, if you were wondering. Also under the same log here, some leafcutter ants and a couple of pancakes. We got some other polydesmids here that look very similar to the tractors, but these ones are very small in comparison and likely adults of whatever species they are. Found one of these guys sitting below some bark, has some interesting colors, and if I prod it, it should ball right back up. Or not, I guess not. Usually they do. I've got a katydid here. Not an incredibly interesting one, but still cool nonetheless. This is one from the genus Chloroscurtis. And when there's a lot of light outside, you can actually see that their eyes are blue, but I guess right now they're black. And this is one of the more delicate species that just feeds on leaves, but they are opportunistic. So they do feed on fruits. And if something is very freshly dead, specifically insects, they will feed on that as well. Oh, off it goes. Got a normal tractor here, sitting in the dirt in his little hideout, eating detritus, I believe, and an albino. This is the furthest albino I've seen from the rest of them, so I'm sure the population is actually quite extensive. We have transitioned to night, and I don't think that we're necessarily going to find different species of millipedes, but I would like to see what the habits of the millipedes that we've already seen are, because I do know that they're partially nocturnal. And I have been seeing some of them out, so we should be able to see several more. Look what we have here, a mating pair of tractor millipedes in the rain. How romantic. But on a serious note, I was waiting to see something like this to confirm their adult size, and yeah, of course these ones are mature. And this seems to be the sort of hot spot for them. See, there's even more over here. Actually, look, another mating pair. This is pretty damn cool. I think this is the adult of the little millipedes I call dragon millipedes during the day. Or I think it's an adult. I don't really know how to tell when adult when millipedes are adults or not, which is kind of sad, but it's true. And I say dragon millipede, but the actual dragon millipedes that I'm referring to are just like a Southeast Asian thing. So I'm using that name erroneously too. They just look a lot like those dragon millipedes. You know which ones I'm talking about. The black and pink ones that you may have seen videos of. Well, this is the first one I've seen since I've been here. I want to see if I can find another one, even though it's probably going to prove a bit tough. Look at this guy, or I guess I should say girl, because I think, and I'm no expert in salamanders, like, at all, I think this Boletta glossa may be gravid. It has a funny-shaped belly, and there are some diseases that can cause bloating, but generally it'll cause translucency in the skin, or whatever kind of epidermis they have, and I don't see that here. So this one may be ready for some eggs, not quite sure. Paired with that, it's also the largest one I've seen so far. They're not a huge species, but still, comparatively. All right, I pulled this log up. Very nice one, I must say. A lot of plant life and stuff. This is the kind of thing that you'd want to have in a terrarium, especially like a bioactive one. I pulled it up. You can see I did quite a bit of digging here because I noticed that there was a bit of a matrix of tunnels here, and I saw one of these guys with their butts poking out. And if it looks like I just planted them here, that's because I did. They were sitting in some wood before, but I wanted them to be easier to videotape. And then I dug a little further just to find this one because I was noticing sort of a trail of frass. Millipede frass is pretty easy to identify. It looks a lot like a worm casting, but a little more well held together, a little more circular, and they're oftentimes more densely packed. Enough about millipede poop. This is the same species of millipede that we saw during the day, the giant one that we found. They were also hanging out with some ants, as you can see here. And I don't know, like, you can just see a couple. I don't know what species of ants those are. They do sting and bite. And that was a good opportunity for me to point out that millipedes are generally not prey for ants. Most ants do not attack millipedes for food and don't really attack them in defense because they generally make pretty good housemates. They're not really a threat and they're not really good to eat either. We've got another dragon here. It looks like this millipede specifically has converged a bit with centipedes. You may have heard of the millipede centipede, which is Edentostoma, and those are centipedes that have evolved to look a lot like millipedes. This feels like kind of the opposite. Whatever kind of wood this is, it's the same one that I found the other millipede on, so they may have a specific tree species that they like to feed on that's decaying. Really cool. All right, well, I'll let that one disappear. This is Skynax elaeocrua. I don't really know the common name. It's something tree frog, obviously. And I don't really want to be mean, but this is kind of as generic as it gets in terms of tree frogs in Central and South America. This is a cacao tree, not a very big leaf. Not a great size reference though, but I will say this is only 4 centimeters long or so. It's an adult, but they are able to change colors like a lot of the frogs out here, which is pretty cool. And that kind of accentuates the pattern at times. So you could say that they change their color, but they also change their appearance in general.
This is a Costa Rican night lizard chilling with a tractor millipede. That's pretty cool. And of course, that's the Lepidophyma reticulatum. As for the millipede, I don't know. I've tried figuring it out, but not much luck. We've got another one of these really big millipedes here. This one's as big as the first one. It looks like it's just sitting there, not even doing anything. These are really funny. I love how fat they are. Really cool species. I think it may have ejected a bit of poison there. Not so sure. And for anyone who doesn't know, there are some round form millipedes that are able to squirt poison. I'm not sure how this is done, but some people have gotten it in their eyes before. So do be careful with that. Me personally, I'm keeping a camera between the millipede and my eyes, so I don't think anything's gonna happen. But anyone who's just handling them casually should be careful with that kind of thing.
That will be all for looking for millipedes in Western Panama. I'd say that was a pretty good success. Yeah, thank you for watching.